Good morning. It is 9 o'clock. It is time to begin our Sunday morning worship service here at Bobby Branch. We're so pleased for everyone that is here in attendance at the building itself this morning. If you're watching us via Facebook, we're glad that you've taken the time to worship here with us. We hope you find the things that we do here at Bobby Branch is according to the New Testament teaching of how we should worship. And if you ever have questions of why we do the things we do, please don't hesitate to ask. As for our announcements this morning, if you want to take your Bible and turn to Romans chapter 5, verses 6 through 8. Romans 5, 6 through 8. That will be our scripture for our lesson this morning. Also, if you're watching, we also stream these as soon as they're over with. They are on YouTube, and it is also on Ben Lohman channel 6. We meet Sunday night at 6 o'clock, and we will have Bible study following services this morning that will end at 11 o'clock, and then, like I said, Sunday night at 6, and then Wednesday night we have Bible study. So please come for that. The area events that are going on starting today, Hiawassee congregation is going to be having a gospel meeting, and that is going through the 6th. Starting next Sunday, our VBS starts on Monday. So if you want to go to some of these other gospel meetings, that would be fine, but our Vacation Bible School starts next Monday. Grundy Street congregation having a gospel meeting. Summitville congregation is a gospel meeting. And Earlyville will be having a Vacation Bible School. Starting 2 weeks today, Arlington is going to be having a Vacation Bible School. And East End and Mount Leo will be having a their congregations are going to have a joint VBS as well. Visitation Group 1, don't forget your meeting tonight following services. Also, next Monday, Vacation Bible School. Youth News, July the 9th, that's this coming Saturday. Disc Golf and Devo, please sign up by Wednesday for that. July the 11th through the 13th, our Vacation Bible School. On the 16th, which will be that weekend, Jason's going to have a VBS reward. For those youth, find an active part, help out in our thing, and Jason's wanting to reward you. July 17th through the 22nd, Short Mountain Bible Camp, that will be the Rutherford Coffee County Week. There is some going for that, so if you need to see Jason, sign up today. Sign up by today. Or see Jason today, for sure. He can give you the cost that you need. On the 24th, Home Devo at Nancy Mayfield's house. 27th is Birthday Wednesday. And then this is a fifth Sunday this month, so we will have a youth-led on the fifth Sunday, so young people see Jason so he can be setting everything up for that. Tonight is our ice cream supper. There are sheets out there if you'd like to sign up for that. Don't forget that. I have a couple of cards here I'd like to read.
on
Zion, glorious summit stood a new rust host, redeemed by blood. May him their king his strength divine. I heard the song and strove to join.
Let us pray together. Our Almighty God, our gracious Father in heaven, you are our great I Am. We thank you, Father, so much for allowing us to speak to you in our prayers. All of our prayers, our individual prayers, Father, and especially our assembled prayer here together today, Father. We're so thankful for this day of worship to you, Father. Help us all to put our minds fully into it. Help us, Father, to be a part of it. Help us, Father, to take everything we can from it and apply it to our own lives. We thank you for this wonderful congregation here at Bybee. We thank you for each and every member. We thank you, Father, for all the works that Bybee Branch does for this community and this world. We thank you for the online lesson that goes out, Father, and for all those who are viewing at this time, Father. We thank you, Father, for our classes. We thank you for our teachers. And for Tony and for Jason and all their work and their families, we ask you to bless them and their families, Father. We pray for those who have been mentioned sick here today, Father. We're praying also, Father, for those who have lost their loved ones. We pray, Father, for those who are in the hospitals now, in the nursing homes, who are about to have surgeries, who are waiting for those surgeries. And
We thank you, Father, for especially those for who have recovered, that our prayers have been answered on their behalf. We thank you, Father, for this eldership, and we thank you, Father, for our deacons and for the ladies here, Father, and all the wonderful things they do for everyone they help, Father. We pray for our upcoming VBS. We pray, Father, it be a success. We thank you, Father, for those who have put their time into it. We pray, Father, for the education it will give to the youth, Father, and to us all, Father. We thank you for the love this congregation has for each other. Help us to always be mindful, Father, to put that love back into each other, to realize, Father, the love we have now will be that same love that we'll share in heaven one day. Help us to treat each other the way you would have us to treat each other. And help us, Father, to love our neighbor as ourselves. And always be willing to forgive others, Father, as you forgive us. We pray for our nation, and we're thankful for it still, Father. We know that in so many ways our nation has turned against you. And we pray, Father, for our leaders that they will realize this, of the mistakes they've made. And we're thankful, Father, for the leaders that do try to turn to you, Father, that try to recognize you as our God. We pray that our nation can once again return to its roots, Father, that as it was established in the beginning, Father. We pray now, Father, you be with us through the remainder of the service. Help us to do everything in truth and spirit and worship you as you deserve to be worshiped. In Christ's name we pray. Amen.
Amen. Our next song will be number 242. Number 242.
We read of a place that's called heaven. It's made from the pure and the free. These truths in God's word he has given. How beautiful heaven must be. How beautiful heaven must be.
First day of the week, we're commanded to give back to God a portion that he's blessed us with, and to help us prepare our minds to offer this blessing, I'll be reading a few verses from 2 Corinthians chapter 9. But this I say, He who sows sparingly will also reap sparingly, and he who sows bountifully will also reap bountifully. So let each one give as he purposes in his heart, not grudgingly or of necessity, for God loves a cheerful giver, and God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you, always having all sufficiency in all things, may have an abundance for every good work. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for so much in this life. We thank you for this good day that you blessed us with and this opportunity we have to gather here, to assemble in thy name, to sing, to worship, to learn more about thee, to fellowship with one another. We know that you are the giver of all good things, and we thank you so much for all these blessings, the spiritual blessings that we enjoy, especially on this first day of the week. But at this time, we want to give you thanks for the blessings of this life that you've provided for us. You've given us talents and abilities that we might go out and earn money and make a living so that we might provide for ourselves and for our families. We thank you for this blessing. We pray that as you have blessed us, that we've laid aside a portion of that that we might give back to you this morning. We pray that the monies collected this morning, the elders would use this money wisely so that our kingdom might flourish, the kingdom might flourish locally and also the world over. We ask this prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen.
For the invitation song this morning, we'll use number 380, number 380. And now as we prepare our minds to partake of the Lord's Supper, we'll sing number 784, 784.
Why did my Savior come to earth?
Oh,
you do not have a communion packet, if you'd raise your hand, one of the ushers would be glad to bring you one at this time. I'll be reading from Mark chapter 14, verses 22 through 25. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread, blessed and broke it, and gave it to them, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." Then he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank from it. And he said to them, "This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for many. Assuredly, I say to you, I will no longer drink of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God." At this time, would you prepare your packet and remove the bread? Let's give thanks. Heavenly Father, we again thank you for so much in this life. You're so good to us, your mercy, your grace, your love for us. We know you loved us so much that you gave your only begotten Son for us. You allowed him to come to this earth to live as we do, yet he did so without committing sin. Yet he was crucified upon that cross at Calvary for no reason. At this time, as we partake of this bread, let us think back to Jesus as his body hung on that cross. And to Christians, this bread represents that broken body. May we all think back to that time, reflect upon our own lives, so that we might partake of this in a worthy manner. It's our prayer in Christ's name. Amen.
Amen.
If you would, at this time, would you open a cup to the fruit of the vine? Let's give thanks. Heavenly Father, again, we thank you for loving us so much. We thank you for Jesus, for our Savior, knowing that he gave his life for us. And let us all think back to that time as he hung upon that cross and that his blood flowed so that we might have forgiveness of our sins. And again, as Christians, we know that this fruit of the vine represents that blood that he shed for us. Let's think back to that time that we all might partake in a worthy and acceptable manner. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Scripture reading this morning is taken from Romans chapter 5, verses 6 through 8. For when we were still without strength in due time, Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet perhaps for a good man someone would even dare to die. But God demonstrates his own love towards us, and that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us.
We're gathered here this morning as Christians with our focus on worshiping God and studying his word. And we as Christians should take some time to understand who God is and understand what he wants us to do. And to do that, we have to take his word and let it direct our lives. This morning, we're going to continue in our study of the book of Romans. And the theme of this is righteousness in Romans. None of us can be righteous of our own. The only way we can do that is to follow God's divine plan for our lives. And what we want to do this morning is to study Romans chapter 5. In order for us to begin, I want to begin by noticing, first of all, that each of us, every one of us, wants someone to love them. We want someone to care for us. And when we think about that, I would ask the questions, how do you know who your true friends are? How do you know that someone truly loves you? Well, if I go to the book of Proverbs, Solomon would say in chapter 14 and verse 20, The poor man is hated even by his own neighbor, but the rich has many friends. If I go further to chapter 19, look at verse 4 and verse 6, we learn that wealth makes many friends. And in verse 6, and every man is a friend to one who gives gifts. And our idea of things, when we think about friendship, we often think about people who will share what they have. That's the reason why people seek the favor and the friendship of those who are well off. But Solomon goes on to say in chapter 17, in verse 17, a friend loves at all times. That's a person who doesn't just give you a gift or do something for you when the season appeals to him, but one who does so at all times. And we learn from chapter 18 and verse 24 that a man who has friends must himself be friendly. He has to be willing to treat others the way he himself wants to be treated. And so love is a two-way street, if you will. And when we think about the greatest of friendship and the greatest of love, we read in John 15 and verse 13, greater love has no one than this, than to lay down one's life for his friends. There's no one greater than Jesus. There's no better friend. We often sing the song about being a friend of Jesus, and he is our great friend, and he truly loves us. Well, Romans 5 reflects upon that love of God in so many fashions and in so many different ways. There's so many different approaches that we could take to John chapter 5. What I want us to do this morning is to look at it from the perspective of time. I want us to look in the past when we were enemies of God, look at the present being the elect of God, and then the future, the eternal life offered by God. Now, if you've got your Bibles, and I hope you do, turn with me to chapter 5. Let's begin our study with verses 6 through 8 and then verse 10. Paul writes, for when we were still without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man will one die, yet perhaps for a good man would someone even dare to die. But God demonstrates his love toward us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. And then verse 10, for if when we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, much more having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. Notice those terms there as he reflects upon who we were and what we were. He uses the when to describe our condition prior to becoming a Christian. And when he does, he notices, for instance, verse 6, when we were without strength. We had no ability to save ourselves. We were not people capable of doing anything. He describes us in verse 6 as the ungodly and in verse 8 as sinners. And then finally in verse 10, he describes us as enemies. While God has been a friend to us, we have been an enemy to him. While God has loved us, we've not really loved him. What this does is to draw attention to our unworthiness and undeserving of God's love. What Paul has done in the book of Romans is to try to portray before everyone their need for the gospel. And we need to see ourselves as who we really are before we become Christians. To see that we need God. We need what he offers to us. Now let me illustrate this by asking the question, who would you die for? Would you die for your family? Most of us, I think, would. Would you die for your friends? Many of us would say, yes, there are dear friends that I would die for. But would you die for a foe? Would you die for your enemy? Would you die for a person who does not love you, does not care about you, will not do anything for you? Well, listen, as Paul in Ephesians 2 and verse 12 reflects on our status before God, he said that at that time you were without Christ, being aliens from the commonwealth of Israel, strangers from the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in this world. Now, in the context, he's describing the Gentile condition, but that initially describes the condition of everyone who is not a Christian. We are without God and having no hope in this world. In the parallel passage in the book of Colossians 1 and verse 21, he says, "And you who were once alienated and enemies in your mind by wicked works, yet now he has reconciled." He describes us as enemies of God because we do not respect God. We do not love God. But we go to 1 John chapter 4, verses 9 and 10, and we draw into this the fact that that didn't stop God. "And this is the love of God was manifested toward us, that God has sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him." Now here's how he puts it. "In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son to be the propitiation for our sins. Not that we love God, but he loved us. It was from his perspective that we look back in the past and see we were not lovable, but God still loved us anyway." Now, there's a second thing that is to be drawn from this. Not only is Paul trying to impress upon them their understanding that they are incapable on their own of saving themselves and that there's a need for God, but there's also the fact that there are people who think, "God can't ever love me. The reason why he can't love me is because I've been too bad." And I've talked to people about becoming Christians before, and the response is, "You just don't know the things I've done. You don't know how I have lived. You don't know where I have gone and all the things that have been a part of my life." And I'll say, "No, I don't know it all, but I know one thing. I know God loves you and gave his Son for you." Paul felt much the same way. In 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 13, he describes himself before becoming a Christian. He said, "Although I was formerly a blasphemer, a persecutor, and an insolent man, but I obtained mercy because I did it ignorantly in unbelief." Paul said, you look at me, and he says, there's no one worse than I am, that you look at all that I've done. And then drop down to verse 15, and he says, "This is a faithful saying and worthy of all acceptance, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners, of whom I am chief." Now he goes on to explain, "However, for this reason I obtain mercy, that in me first Jesus Christ might show all long-suffering as a pattern of those who are going to believe on him for everlasting life." Paul said, you look at me, and if God could save me, he can save you. You look at the things I have done, how I persecuted the church, how I blasphemed the name of the Lord. And he said, if God can forgive me, God can forgive you as well. So God loved you when you didn't love him. But Jesus also died for the people who put him on the cross. When I go to Isaiah 53, verse 12, as well as Luke chapter 23 and verse 34, I have a picture given to me of what the Lord did while he was on the cross. Isaiah captured it in his prophecy by saying, "And he was numbered with the transgressors, and he bore the sins of many, and made intercession for the transgressors." In Luke 23, he said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do." They do not know what they do. There are people who do not realize that God loves them and Jesus is willing to forgive them even while they were sinners. Now, a lot of us look back and say, boy, the Lord was really, really merciful to look down on those people who had called out, crucify him, crucify him, and forgive them. But do you realize it is my sins and your sins that also put Jesus on that cross? If it were just me and my sins, the Lord's blood would have been shed. And so I can't look at those people who said crucify him any more harshly than I would look at myself. So as Paul looks at the past here, he says we were enemies of God. But then he uses some timing words. He will say when, referring to the past, and then he will talk about now. Look with me at verses 9 through 11 in this context. Much more then, having now been justified by his blood, we shall be saved from wrath through him. For if when we were enemies we were reconciled to God through the death of his son, much more, having been reconciled, we shall be saved by his life. And not only that, but we rejoice in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we now have received the reconciliation. Paul's trying to say, you look back at who we were, but you contrast that with who we are now. Now, their present state was one of being justified. That's an important word in the book of Romans, to be justified. That's a person who is now standing in a right relationship with God. But how did I get to that state of being right with God? Well, that's the answer that Paul provides in the first part of this chapter. Go back with me to chapter 1. Let's look at verses, really 1 and 2 will be sufficient. Therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which we stand and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. Justified by faith. That is God's plan to save man. Do you remember going back to chapter 1 and verse 17? He said, for the just shall live by faith. And he said that provides for us access to the grace of God. So it is the fact that we get to be justified. But when I keep reading in the book of Romans, I get to chapter 8. And verses 30 through 39, and we can't read all of that, but I'm going to put it on the screen in case you want to follow through. But that's where we learn that it is the elect who are justified. Listen as Paul speaks. Moreover, whom he predestined, these he also called. And whom he called, these he also justified. And whom he justified, these he also glorified. And then he's going to say, what will we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us? And then he goes off into the same point that he made back in chapter 5 in verses 6 through 8, talking about the love of God, how much love Jesus had for us. And then he will continue on and say, in verse 38 and 39, for I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come, nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing shall be able to separate us from the love of God which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. What Paul is trying to get the Romans to understand that once you become a child of God, it is God who loves you, and you are now the justified, you are the elect, you are the called of God. But there are many people who struggle with this teaching in the New Testament of predestination. They struggle with the idea of saying, well, how does God call me? Is it some mysterious feeling that I may have in the night or during the day sometime that I feel where I'm humbled and I feel that I am unworthy of God? Or is it when I learn what God has said? Well, I refer you back again to chapter 1 and verse 16. Paul said, I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God to salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. The power of the gospel. That power is able to save us. Well, in 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 14, Paul would write, to which he called you by our gospel. You see, the gospel is to go into all the world to every man. Mark 16, verses 15 and 16. And we learn that as the gospel goes to every creature, to every man, that we all get the call to become Christians. However, only those who answer that call become the elect. God has elected to save you, but you make the choice whether or not he does. Now, what that also implies is that I have to stay there as well. That I have to make sure that if God has chosen to put me in that place of blessing to being the elect. And when Peter wrote in 2 Peter 1 and verse 10, he said, therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. What we understand is that he's calling on us to make our call and election sure, that we're doing what God would have us to do. Now, the third lesson in this is the focus on eternal life. In fact, Paul is going to use the word hope to describe this. Now, turn back with me to chapter 5. Let's look again at verses 2 through 5. And then we'll take verses 17 and 18 and then verses 20 and 21. Through whom also we have access by faith into this grace in which you stand, or which we stand, and rejoice in the hope of the glory of God. And not only that, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulation produces perseverance, and perseverance character, and character hope. Now, hope does not disappoint because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit whom was given to us. Now, if you were here Wednesday night, Brother Paul did a great job of extending the invitation and using this verse, verse 5, talking about hope that does not disappoint. In fact, I remember as a child singing the hymn, there's no disappointment in heaven. No one will ever look and say, I wish I hadn't come here. In fact, eternal life will be such bliss that you and I ought to look for it and live for it and strive after it. Now, when I drop down to verse 17, he said, for if by one man's offense death reigned through the one, much more those who receive the abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness will reign through the one, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as through one man's offense, judgment came to all men, resulting in condemnation, even so through one man's righteous act, the free gift came to all men, resulting in justification of life. What he's trying to do is say there's reason for our hope. The reason of it is looking and seeing what Jesus did. I look and see how sin entered into the world through Adam, and then I see how life entered into this world through Jesus Christ. Now, verses 20 and 21. He said, moreover, the law entered that the offense might abound, but where sin abounded, grace abounded much more. So that sin reigned in death, even so grace might reign through righteousness to eternal life through Jesus Christ our Lord. He's trying to get us to see the parting of the ways, if you will, the two paths. One path with sin led to death. The other path with Jesus led to grace and eternal life. And what he's trying to get them to see is that's what your future will be. We want to go to heaven. We want to be with God. So God offers man the choice of life or death. Again, there's a real valuable section found in chapter 2 in verses 6 through 11. And he's talking about there that God will render to each according to his deeds. He said eternal life to those who by patience, continuance, and doing good seek for glory, honor, and immortality. But to those who are self-seeking and do not obey the truth, but obey unrighteousness, indignation and wrath, tribulation and anguish on every soul of man who does evil, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. But glory and honor and peace to everyone who works what is good, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. For there is no partiality with God. He said, it's really a choice of what you yourself want to do. Do you want to go be with God? Do you want that future that is good and right? Then choose to do what is right. Obey the truth and do not obey unrighteousness. When Paul wrote Titus, he talked about this same idea more than once. But I want you to notice in chapter 1 and verse 2, he says, in hope of eternal life, which God had cannot lie, promised before time began. And then in chapter 3, verse 7, having been justified by his grace, we should become heirs according to the hope of eternal life. Paul is saying you want something in the future. You want hope. Hope is for that eternal life that God provides. And God has provided this so that everyone could be saved. For you, for me, for the man that is white, the man that is black, the man that is rich, the man that is poor, the man that is educated, the man that's uneducated. It doesn't matter. Everyone is important to God. When Paul was speaking about offering prayers for all men, he said, God desires all men to be saved and to come to a knowledge of the truth. All men. And that's the reason why we preach the gospel. That's the reason why we have radio programs. That's the reason why we have Bible correspondence courses. That's the reason why we send missionaries into foreign fields. Because God wants every soul saved. Now I'll come back to the beginning. We think about friendship. Think about love. No one has done any more for you than God. No one loves you more than God. No one has taken better care of you than God. And that's what Paul is trying to impress upon them, is that you ought to appreciate God's love, his mercy, and his goodness. He has been a true friend. There's three passages which I thought would be helpful. In Proverbs 27 and verse 6, which happens to be a part of our last class, faithful are the wounds of a friend, but the kisses of an enemy are deceitful. Faithful are the wounds of a friend. When I go to God's word wounds me. It tells me I'm not living right. It tells me I've got things to change in my life. In Job 5 and verse 17, behold, happy is the man whom God corrects. Therefore, do not despise the chastening of the Almighty. If God looks at me and he sees I need correction, he provides it in his word. Revelation 3 verse 19, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Therefore, be zealous and repent. God is looking at each one of us and saying, there's sin in your life. You need to repent of it. If you're not a Christian, you ought to become one. You see, God is calling for repentance on the part of every man. It's not just that I need to repent or you need to repent. It's everybody that does. In Acts 17, verse 30, the times of this ignorance God overlooked, but now commands all men everywhere to repent. And it says he's not slack concerning his promises. Some count slackness, but is long-suffering, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. If you read the book of Romans, you walk away with an appreciation of looking at yourself and looking at your past. You also appreciate looking at yourself and looking at your present. What has God done for me and where am I? If you're a Christian, you're the elect of God. But he also points us to the future, toward the eternal life and the hope that is in it. And we ask the question, are you willing to receive God's free gift? If you're not a Christian this morning, we're going to sing the song, Just As I Am. And that's a fitting way to think about ourselves this morning. Just as I am. If you need to become a Christian, come in faith, repenting of those sins, confessing your faith, and being baptized. If you are a Christian and you're walking in the ways of the world, you need to repent also. Let's pray together. Would you come as we stand and sing?
Song will be number 226.
Well, good morning, and once again, we want to thank each and every one of you for joining us for our services here at Bobby Branch Church of Christ this morning. Also want to extend a thank you for those who may be watching via Facebook Live, and those who may be watching this as recorded and being on YouTube or on Ben Lohman Channel 6. If you are watching these services via those web services or cable TV, we encourage you. We are meeting in person, And we encourage you to join us at each and every opportunity that you can for our worship and our Bible study periods here at Bobby Branch. Tony, I want to thank you for another wonderful lesson this morning. And Caleb, thank you for the song selections and leading us in those. So don't forget, tonight we will have Brother Jim Dearman will be with us as we continue our summer series. And again, our series is on man's search for meaning. So I know each and everyone will enjoy to be able to hear Brother Jim Dearman as he speaks God's words to us. And if you do come back tonight, we have a very special treat, ice cream. So we'll have our annual ice cream fellowship or ice cream supper this evening following services. So I know many of you have already been making your favorite or someone else's favorite ice cream. And so we're looking for as desserts as well. So we're looking forward to that as well. So at this time, we'll have one more hymn and a closing prayer.
Oh, Lord, my God, when
Father, we truly see that how great thou art. We thank thee, Heavenly Father, that we have been afforded the opportunity to come together this morning and to worship and to study from thy word. We pray that each one here has been edified and will leave this place with a stronger faith and be better able to serve as a Christian in the coming week. We ask thee, Heavenly Father, to always forgive us of our sins, for we know that we sin and fall short, and that with the blood of Jesus applied to our lives, that we can be forgiven of these sins. Please go with us and bring us back at the next appointed time, for it's in Christ's holy name we pray. Amen.